How many of you are grandmothers? How many of you know a grandmother? Everybody. All over the world, grandmothers are creating a better future for their grandchildren and yours and mine. I first began meeting them when I was working in rural Kenya, and I was sitting in a circle of women, and just to make conversation before I began working with them, I said, "How many children do you have?" And the first one said, "I have 5 and 10 adopted." And the next one said, "I have 6 and 15 adopted." And the next one said, "I have 4 and 12 adopted." And suddenly, as I was listening to this routinized way in which they were answering, I realized that what they were really telling me was that they were raising their grandchildren who had been orphaned by AIDS. So much sadness. That year, as I worked all over the continent of Africa, I found grandmothers who were raising their grandchildren who had been orphaned by AIDS. I left thinking, the future of this continent rests in the hands of the grandmothers. I'm a grandmother too, just like many of you. I came back to the United States and did some research because I wondered what grandmothers were doing other places. And very quickly, I found grandmother groups, activist grandmother groups, in more than 30 countries. Unbeknownst to almost anybody, including me at that point, there is underway an international grandmothers movement. These are women who look around at our troubled world and say, "Not good enough for my grandchildren," and get to work. Ultimately, I went all over the world. I interviewed and photographed 120 grandmothers in 17 grandmother groups in 15 countries. In the Middle East, in Africa, in Asia, in Latin America, in the United States. They invited me into their homes. They introduced me to their children. Sometimes we danced. Sometimes they dressed me up in their saris because if I was wearing a black t-shirt, they didn't think that was anywhere nearly as bright and fun as grandmothers should be wearing. Learned a lesson. I met these women as my sisters, but by the time I finished this project, they were my heroes. So I want to introduce you to some of my heroes tonight, starting with grandmothers in India who have learned how to be solar engineers. One in every 5 people in the world lives without electricity. 200 Indian illiterate grandmothers began to study engineering, solar engineering, at the Barefoot College in Rajasthan, India. When they returned to their villages and brought electricity, everything changed. Midwives could see to deliver babies in the middle of the night. Children no longer got lung diseases from studying by kerosene lanterns. Those grandmothers returned to the Barefoot College to teach other Indian grandmothers how to do this special skill. Wanting to encourage the use of solar electricity all over the world, the United Nations began sending grandmothers from many countries to study with the Indian grandmothers. I was there when 20 grandmothers from Africa, 2 each from 10 countries, arrived in Rajasthan to study with the Indian grandmothers. Now I ask you, if you were an Indian grandmother, exactly how would you teach somebody who spoke a completely different language? In fact, many different languages. If you were an Indian grandmother, you would teach by color coding, and experimentation, and demonstration, and gestures. Solar grandmothers have electrified households in 77 countries. 77 countries in the Middle East and Africa, Asia, and Latin America. Solar electricity now charges cell phones so they can do electronic banking. And it powers refrigerators, which they'd never had before at all. The solar grandmothers are viewed as VIPs. The man who runs the Barefoot College said to me, "I meet them as grandmothers, but they go back to their villages as tigers." Grandmothers are ending female genital mutilation in Senegal. Grandmothers are the authorities on family health in many cultures. An NGO, a non-governmental organization called the Grandmother Project, discovered that when grandmothers' traditional knowledge was augmented with just a little bit of contemporary medical information, huge change happened. When the Senegalese grandmothers learned from the community health workers that their daughters were dying in childbirth as a result of FGM, from hemorrhaging, they were shocked. It was, in fact, the grandmothers who had perpetuated this tradition. In fact, it was they who had conducted the cutting. It was so long between the cutting and the birthing that they had never made this connection until they talked to the community health workers. They sought support immediately from imams and from headmen and from school principals, and they all vowed to work with the grandmothers to help end this practice. First, the grandmothers asked the villagers, whom they convened in intergenerational meetings, meeting after meeting after meeting, to talk about this. First, the grandmothers asked the villagers to identify good traditions that should be continued. People named traditional dancing and riddles and storytelling and games, proverbs. And then they invited villagers to talk about bad traditions that they could agree should be discontinued. Ultimately, 20 villages surrounding Velingara in the southeast corner of Senegal, 20 villages over a three-year period, talked and talked and talked, and ultimately every single one of them agreed to abandon the practice of FGM. By the way, they also agreed to stop the practice of child marriage and to stop encouraging teen pregnancy. Grandmothers now teach in the high schools about those issues. Hawa Baldi told me before, "We were like animals living in the forest together, but not working together." Dado Baldi said, "If I told you the importance of the grandmothers in the village, in the household, in the education of children, it would take all morning." Grandmothers are fighting child obesity in Ireland. There is just plain nothing as healthy as homegrown, home-cooked food. Dorina Allen, who runs the slow food movement in Ireland, worried about obese children. She said, "It's not their fault. Cooking skills have been lost." So she, working with the American chef Alice Waters, invented the idea of International Grandmother's Day. Did you know there was one? It's in April. Their idea was that on this day, grandmothers would teach their grandchildren how to plant and fish and forage, how to harvest, how to cook fresh, nutritious food. I documented Grandmother's Day starting in County Cork in Dorina's own kitchen, where her grandchildren were learning to bake scones and have a tea party. In Waterford, grandmothers and grandchildren were planting seeds, peas, and corn that would produce come summer. I ended the day, zooming around, I ended the day in Dublin with Monica Murphy and Meg Wood and their granddaughters, there were seven of them, who were cooking dinner
together. Meg's granddaughter, Emily, proved, beyond the shadow of a doubt, something that you may have found out yourself, which is that a missing front tooth is not enough to stop you from gobbling down a cupcake. Grandmothers are battling against human rights abuse in Israel. Every day, 70 to 100,000 Palestinians pass through the military checkpoints, getting to doctor's appointments and schools and jobs. Often, after the soldiers have checked their identity cards, they may be sent to another line to start all over again. They may have been waiting 4 hours. Some of them are refused entry completely. There's never any explanation. Now, I understand that armies are taught to control people whom they are occupying, and they are occupied territories. And delay is one way that's done. However, the Israeli grandmothers found that unacceptable, and here's why. Between 2000 and 2006, 68 women gave birth while they were waiting at the checkpoints. 35 of them miscarried. 5 of them died. Israeli grandmothers couldn't stand that. Between 2001 and 2004, 3 years, 991 Palestinians who were trying to go to doctors in Israel, in Jerusalem, were stopped at the checkpoint and denied military access. 83 of them died in the checkpoints. So two by two, the Israeli grandmothers, the Jewish Israeli grandmothers, have monitored the checkpoints throughout the West Bank ever since the Second Intifada, 2002, 14 years. They've documented farmers' products rotting because they can't get them to market in the heat, students missing final exams, bridegrooms missing their own weddings. The grandmothers report human rights abuse daily to the Knesset, to journalists, and on the internet. You could find their reports online right now. Today, they've actually made some changes. Today, some checkpoints have drinking water, some have bathrooms, some have chaid, some have hotlines for human rights assistance. The grandmothers are part of an NGO called Maxim Watch, means checkpoint watch. Like observant Jews everywhere, they teach their grandchildren to treat other people the way they would like to be treated. Hannah Barag, this is she, took me to checkpoints all over the West Bank. The work that these grandmothers do is dangerous and controversial. Soldiers in their own families don't support it. And yet, these Jewish Israeli grandmothers have won the highest award for civil rights in Israel. Grandmothers are working for literacy in Argentina. This is a story especially for the National Writers Series. Even in a world where we all read on Kindles and iPads, many children are still illiterate. That's especially true, surprisingly enough, in Argentina, where during the military dictatorship between 1976 and 1983, the military burned libraries, bombed newspaper offices, looted libraries, and killed authors and journalists and intellectuals. No surprise. People all over Argentina stopped reading. It was simply too dangerous to read. They were terrified. Years later, the Mempo Giardinelli Foundation invited grandmothers to begin reading to grandchildren. They remembered how to read. The grandmothers inspired so many children to learn to read that their program has been incorporated into the national school curriculum and copied by 8 other countries, including Spain. Today, 2,000 grandmothers in Argentina, they're each assigned to a specific classroom and they go every week. And they read every week. It turns out that unconditional love of children and unconditional love of good literature, JET propels children's interest in reading, and in school, by the way. In black, on your left, is Sylvia DeVici. She told me, when I retired, I asked myself, what about my diploma and all my experience and training? Where is it going to go? In a box? This work, she said, has opened new worlds for me. Another grandmother, Maria Alicia Assane, reflected on the children's reactions to the grandmother's stories. Their eyes shine, they smile, she said. Those things fill my heart with joy. Reading, she said, is an act of love. Grandmothers are fighting for justice in the Philippines. During World War II, this church was a brothel. The Japanese army kidnapped an adolescent girl to have sex with every 100 soldiers, no matter what part of Asia it was in. 30 garrisons in the Philippine Islands doubled as comfort stations, where sex slaves were imprisoned between 1942 and 1945 and forced to serve as many as 10 men a night. For 50 years, the comfort women hid their stories, even from their own husbands and children. And then one of them, one daring woman, went on television and told her story and invited the other women who had been sex slaves during this time to join her to fight for their rights. The grandmothers are called Lolas in Tagalog. They transformed their shame into political action. In 1993, they filed a class action suit against the Japanese government. They asked for a formal apology, reparations, and a place in the history books so their experience would never be repeated again. After 10 years going through the courts, the Japanese Supreme Court rejected the case. They did not give up. Most are now in their 80s and 90s, but they demonstrate in the streets, they speak at universities, they collect signatures on petitions, and sometimes in the afternoon, they dance. They dance in their bungalow, which was donated to them as a clubhouse by sympathetic Japanese citizens. Their fight will not end when they die. They are building international support to keep women and girls everywhere safe from sexual violence. This is Narcissa. She told me the whole world must fight for the next generation. Grandmothers are fighting for the environment in Thailand. When Tongabai Pongtawang sits at her loom, she looks out at a beautiful mountain, and she knows that on the other side of that mountain, a mining company is mining for gold. As a result, rivers are contaminated with cadmium, arsenic, lead, and manganese. When locals took blood tests, cyanide was found in 63% of the samples. Mercury and lead were found in every single one. Tongabai's grandmother group, they are weavers who grow organic cotton and dye and spin it, and then weave. They voted unanimously to donate some of their profits to the people in the villages surrounding them who had lost their livelihood and their health. These women traveled from Lue province, which is in the northeast, all the way to Bangkok and spoke with officials there. They cited the Constitution, and they cited what I thought was a uniquely Buddhist argument that was based on morality, compassion, and the interconnectedness of public officials and their constituents. But the mine is still producing. I hope that children like this, will live a long time to wear the jackets, the organic cotton jackets that their grandmothers produce for them. Grandmothers are raging against political disaffection in the United States. The raging grannies don crazy hats and dowdy aprons. They write and sing witty song lyrics. They stage playful protests, all to earn media attention for the issues that they believe will be good or bad for their grandchildren. There are some 60 granny gaggles. They call them gaggles, these groups, in 5 countries. In fact, there is one in Detroit. I had documented the San Francisco Bay Area gaggle. This is Granny Gail. Granny Gail still participates in protests from her disability scooter. She's had 2 hip replacements. She writes their song lyrics. This is Ruth Robertson. Ruth Robertson has a collection of really dowdy hats in her dining room and aprons that none of us would ever wear. Reminds me of the one I had to make in 8th grade. She says to people who are interested in joining at our gigs, you don't even have to be able to sing. You can just mouth the words if you're tone deaf. You don't even have to be a grandmother. All you have to be is somebody who's willing to wear a crazy hat. Everywhere when I mentioned grandchildren, the grandmother showed me pictures. Wouldn't you? I would too. Barbara Baxter Berman told me that her 10-year-old girl is a bright, shining girl. And I decided that even though raging grannies rage, they have big hearts. Indigenous grandmothers, they are praying for the earth and for peace. A shared prophecy connects many tribal people. It promises that women from the 4 directions will awaken the world. The International Council of 13 Indigenous Grandmothers, all healers and shamans, hold public meetings every 6 months. Each one conducts a ceremony, a ceremony in her own tradition. And they pray for the environment, and they pray for peace. I interviewed and photographed them when they were in Sedona, Arizona. Jyoti, who first convened this group, told me, the grandmothers are challenging us to open our hearts with love, hope, and charity. The 13 indigenous grandmothers have prayed at St. Peter's in Rome. They have had an audience with the Dalai Lama in India. They helped to get water issues on the United Nations agenda, and they have preserved sacred sites around the world. Their commitment statement says, we believe that our ancestral ways of prayer, peacemaking, and healing will lead us and light our way through an uncertain future. Grandmothers are recapturing traditions in Peru. In many cultures, as we said before, in many cultures, it's the grandmothers who sustain traditions. In Peru, they saved one. By 1972, nobody was wearing traditional clothing in the high country, in the Andes of Peru. Traditional weaving methods had been lost. The ancestors had been betrayed. Nilukalanyapa founded a group of grandmothers, weavers, it's called the Center for Traditional Textiles of Cusco, to bring back traditional weaving. She told me only the grandmothers knew the names of the processes, the stories of the patterns, the technical information about dyes and looms. She got local high schools to give their high school students academic credit for interviewing their grandmothers about their grandmothers' weaving. And little by little, the students and the grandmothers collected enough information that they could begin teaching other people how to do traditional weaving again. So now, maybe some of you have been to the Sacred Valley of the Inca, you would find that the women and men there are wearing traditional clothing again with great pride. My last two stories are about the Stephen Lewis Foundation Grandmothers to Grandmothers campaign. It helps African grandmothers, back to the start, some of the ones whom I met, it helps African grandmothers who are raising grandchildren who have been orphaned by AIDS. The Stephen Lewis Foundation is the beneficiary of 100% of my author royalties from The Grandmother Power, the book. The foundation coordinates 240 groups of Canadian grandmothers, 8,000 grandmothers across Canada. In the past 10 years, they have raised $24 million to send in small cash infusions to groups of grandmothers in 15 African countries. To represent the 8,000 Canadian grandmothers, I photographed the grandmothers and grandothers of Barrie, Ontario. These women will do almost anything to raise money for their African sisters. They will cater weddings, they will have dinner parties, they will sell ice cream at the beach. The week I was there, the Barrie group was making crafts for a holiday Christmas gift fair. They had made teddy bears, and dolls, and sweaters, and art, and wreaths. They set up their booth, and it was swamped. Their profits exceeded their wildest dreams, so they broke into a gratitude dance. The woman in the red jacket is here. She drove from Ontario to celebrate with us tonight. Her name is Joanne O'Shea, and why don't you stand up for a minute, Joanne, please, so everybody can see you. She brought with her two members of her group, grandmothers and grandothers. A grandother is Joanne's husband, Michael O'Shea. Michael. And a grandmother member is Kathy Dunn. Be sure to talk to them later. The Stephen Lewis Foundation is starting grandmother groups in the United States. Do you know how much I would love it if the first United States grandmother group started in Traverse City? Let's do it. Okay, back to our story. Joanne was dancing a gratitude dance. By the way, if you want, she will teach you the gratitude dance before we leave tonight. So gratitude is just in the DNA of her grandmother group. She sent me off with these words. She said, when you meet the grandmothers in South Africa, tell them what a gift they are to us. Every day, she said, every day is Thanksgiving because of them. Finally, the grandmothers of South Africa. South Africa has the highest number of people with HIV/AIDS, almost 7 million. Grandmothers Against Poverty and AIDS, GAPA for short, Grandmothers Against Poverty and AIDS, is an NGO in Khayelitsha Township outside of Cape Town. Crimes and gangs are rampant. GAPA, which is a Stephen Lewis Foundation grantee, is run by and for grandmothers. 80% of all of the GAPA grandmothers are taking care of children who are were orphaned by AIDS. Some of them are HIV positive themselves. Another 30% take care of an additional relative who is HIV positive or has AIDS, and 15% of them are HIV positive themselves. It made me so sad to think about these women's lives, that when I asked the first woman, how are you doing? I just braced myself. Nothing prepared me for her response, which was, "I feel strong." The Gapa grandmothers started an after-school program for the children. It's the only one in Kailicha. School gets out at 1 o'clock. 135 hungry kids come to their center, swarm in for lunch. They have been preparing it all morning. The children laugh and shout and climb all over the playground equipment, which they bought, by the way, with money that came from the Canadian grandmothers. The African grandmothers teach each other craft skills so that they can afford to earn enough money to feed the grandchildren. This is Rita. She learned how to make hats. She told me, "Hats were the end of poverty in my house. They call me Hats Mama." There is bread in the house. There are eggs in the fridge. I've got something in my purse. I've got power. Which brings me to the subject of grandmother power. We have a guest in the audience in addition to Joanne O'Shea and her group, whom you will meet very soon. Jackson Kaguri founded another grantee of the Stephen Lewis Foundation. It's called Nyaka, AIDS Orphan Project. Jackson works with 93 grandmother groups in Uganda. They are raising 43,000 grandchildren who have been orphaned by AIDS. 43,000. So Jackson, in a little while, will tell you more about his project. Maybe some of you met him out here. He has written not only two books for adults, but three books for children. He will sign some for you. They are fundraisers for his wonderful organization. I want to end by just talking a little bit about the International Grandmothers Movement. Do you know that there are more grandmothers in the United States today? 43 million grandmothers in the US. The average age for a first-time grandmother here is 47. Surprise. But if you think about it, if you had a baby when you were 22 and she had a baby when she was 42, when she was 22, suddenly you're at 47 pretty easily. So those people between 47 and 64 are the boomers. They know they can change the world. They grew up in the 60s. They changed the world. Many of them here in the Northern Hemisphere have worked outside the home. It makes them particularly effective. So, as I said, they get to work. For a long time, you know, there were no grandmothers or grandfathers, for that matter. People died when they were 30 for millennia. So we're at a unique point in time in which there are more grandmothers everywhere, and there is in our troubled world a real need for them to work together to make things better for their grandchildren. I am hoping, my dream about this book and about this evening, is that you all, whether you're a grandmother or a grandother, I am hoping you all will be inspired to join the International Grandmothers Movement. If you go to the project website, which is www.globalgrandmotherpower, you will find a list of grandmother groups all over the country. If you go into the exhibit, and I hope you will too, you will find a list of local grandmother groups, and I'm hoping that there are about to be more. In other words, I'm hoping that all of you grandmothers or grandothers will join together to make this world a better place for grandchildren, yours and mine, and grandchildren all around the world. I am convinced that it will take all of us, working together to create hope and possibility for our world. So I thank you.
Thank you, Paola, very, very much. It prompted me to think of several things backstage listening to you about the reason, I mean, we need this grandmother power in our own communities here. And I hope those of you in the audience, one of you starts that group. The connection between generations is immeasurable, and I think only in America do we kind of sometimes celebrate the peccadilloes of youth over the fulsomeness of age. And we need to have both in our debate as we move forward and plan our city. Talking about that, about the past, coming forward to the future, I want to bring out now Tony Demin, who's going to sit down in this chair with Paola. It's a special honor for me to do that. I'll be brief. Oh, here he is. Tony Demin. I've known Tony since we played Little League for Dino's Pizza at the Civic Center. Tony is a photographer. He went to the Brooks Institute in Santa Barbara, California. I was impressed early on of his adventuresome spirit for him taking off to California and do that to do something called photography. And lo and behold, later in life, when I was working at Esquire magazine and Men's Journal and outside, I thought, why not call Tony? So we set off in these series of adventures. We ended up fly fishing for sailfish in Costa Rica, a thing neither of us knew how to do at all. Yet there we were engaged in a contest with a world-class guy. It's a funny story I'll go into later. We went to Patagonia and nearly drowned. I'll forever remember sitting in a Zodiac in an enormous storm with the boat completely filled with water. Our friend Ernesto sitting on the outboard and it's sunk up to the spark plug. No radio, no life vests, and no one knew where we were. And we were bailing, literally, I was bailing with a teacup and Tony was bailing with a teapot. And I thought, why am I about to drown? To write a story for Men's Journal about fishing? It's a good question. And I think it kind of fuels what Paola is about to talk about with Tony. He has been all over the world besides that. He lives now in Traverse City and he happens to be married to my sister, Deborah. Welcome, Tony. Take it away.
Thanks. Hello. Hello, hello. I don't think this is on.
Hello? Can you hear me?
Okay. Sorry, this is my first time doing this, so bear with me. My wife had dressed me, and she
wanted me to wear this shirt, and I
said, it's a little loud, don't you think? But I want to thank Paola and Jackson for setting me at ease. Thank you.
I don't know, you look like a guy who would have tea in a boat.
Yes.
Teacups in a teapot.
Teapots in a boat in Argentina. So this is not your first time in Traverse City?
It is not. This is probably my spiritual home. You know, my family built one of the first cottages right in the middle of Sleeping Bear Bay in 1951. So I am a summer person.
Fudgy? Fudgy?
No, they didn't have fudge here then.
Oh, we do.
Fudge hadn't been invented yet.
So what'd you do today? With your free time?
Oh, I was honored to take Joanne and Michael and Kathy Dunn with me on a tour around Leelanau County. And we ended with lunch in Glen Arbor with my great longtime friend, Mary Sutherland. Yes, we had lunch at the Cherry Republic. Go there.
Go to the Cherry Republic. So M22 and Glen Arbor all brings back a lot of memories to you.
Oh, yes.
Did you make it to the M22 store?
No.
You didn't. Well, through grandmother power, my mother-in-law, the grandmother of my children, stopped by and got you one of these today for your car.
So, that is fantastic.
Thank you, Bonnie.
That went right past our house. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Oh, nice.
Yes. So tell me about your process, about the you're living, as a photographer, you're living every photographer's dream, really, with what you're doing, the places you're going, the people you're meeting. Tell me, how did it get started? I mean, what made you think that at 55 you could turn yourself into a photographer and a writer?
No kidding. I ask myself that question all the time. I had been in business for 35 years. And the last one of those years, I had been teaching at Stanford a course about women and leadership. And between those two things, I was exhausted. I had been commuting all over the world. And so the next consequence was that I had a million frequent flyer miles. And because I'd been doing two jobs, I had earned 1 year of money, a free year. So I thought, I'm going to spend that 1 year, doing only what I love most and want to learn next. And what I loved most was photography. My father put a camera in my hand when I was 8. And I also loved travel. And I was very interested. It was 1995, the year of the Beijing Conference, of the UN Fourth World Conference on Women. And I had heard that women were sending their children to school with the money they earned in cultures where men were given the prerogative to spend the money they earned on bicycles and beer and radios and other things. So I thought, those women are heroic. I want to meet them. Nobody was yet talking about microcredit. And I had lived my life inside of large corporations. So I thought, I want to meet those women who are starting their own businesses. I want to talk to them. And that turned out to be the first book. I visited 90 craftswomen in 12 countries using my frequent flyer miles. It took 5 years. And one day, in the middle of the breadbasket of Bolivia, the sun was going down. I was standing in the back of a Toyota pickup truck, leaning on the hood of the truck, or on the cab roof, shooting as the sun went down. It was so beautiful, and I thought, I am happier than I have ever been working. I'm not going back. And my wonderful husband, who had 2 million frequent flyer miles, said, I'll give you those so you can do more books. And I am still doing books on frequent flyer miles.
So 1 year turned into 22.
1 year turned into 22. That's called the great underestimate.
And so where did you learn your photography skills? Did you just do it on your own, or did you have schooling
or
workshops?
Well, I was very much self-taught. And my father had said important things like, don't have anything in the edges of your picture. Put the person in the middle. A lot of things that we now violate. And the first book came out, I am so nearsighted that I looked at those pictures and I had shot everybody like this. I had like 250 headshots. I could have shot them in my living room. This was not good. So I thought, I better get better. And I began taking workshops at the Santa Fe Photographic Workshops and the Maine Photographic Workshops, always with National Geographic photographers. Because I thought, I don't have any time, I'm 55, I can't start at the beginning and I have to learn fast. So I went to Cuba with Alex Webb and I took a course from David Allen Harvey and really the luminous people whose work I had admired.
Again, living the dream.
Living the
Every
dream.
Every photographer's dream, yes.
No. And I will never forget, in Cuba with Alex Webb, I set my camera so that I could shoot with a very great depth of field, so everything would be in focus all the way along the way, for those of you who are as not having different kinds of cameras. And I didn't touch those settings for 10 days. And I looked at those pictures when they came back and I thought, who shot these? They gave me the wrong film back. It was 2001.
Because everything was in focus, or?
Everything was in focus all the way back, and I could see this huge world that I don't see right. when I'm looking at you.
Right.
I see you.
Right.
Because I'm so nearsighted. But it changed the way I see.
Huh. Wow. So when you go into these situations, what's your strategy to go and meet these women and photograph them?
Oh, I never go any place without having assured myself that there was a story there to find. So I do about a year's worth of research before I begin traveling. And I will have written to the nonprofit organizations and the groups and gained their agreement to be part of a book. And the first thing I do when I meet the women is show them my old books, my other books, mm-hmm. so that they are sure what they're getting into, and they agree to be part of it. You know, many of them are illiterate. Some of them have never seen books, wow. much less owned them. So it's important to explain, and because mine are photographic books, they understand immediately, and they become very engaged and interested in what women are doing other places,
do you
which
show
they
them,
may never see.
Do you show them the photos as you're working, too? Or?
Not very often. I always take, the first picture I take is always a response to my question, how would you like to be photographed? And you know, in places where there are no smartphones, that often gives rise to poses like this. I mean, it is a very formal procedure to have your food.
So it's weird taken. To them when you do this with them?
Yeah. But they are always just stunned when I say, thank you very much. I will send you that one. But then I just keep on shooting. And usually I will have talked to them for an hour first. I will have interviewed them first. So I know that they're going to pick up their child at school or they're going to go to the market. And I say, can I come with you?
Mm-hmm.
They think I'm just crazy. They can't imagine why I'm taking all those pictures. But it's those trips to the market and to pick up the kids that give me pictures like these.
Well, it's quite a contrast because a lot of the words are heartbreaking and the stories are heartbreaking, but your photos are all filled with joy and love, and so it's like two different things going on within your books.
Life is complicated. There yeah. are sometimes at least two different things going on.
Right, right, right. So, and you, okay, the grandmothers that you've encountered, they have so little, many of them have so little, and yet they're so generous with the resources they do have. How do you explain that? What drives them? How do they find it within themselves?
I think if you had suddenly 12 or 15 grandchildren who were totally reliant on you, you had just buried your own children. These are heartbreaking experiences. The children are grieving. You are grieving. But after the funerals, the children run to the grandmothers. They're the only family they have. And if that many children, if even one child is relying on you, you somehow plumb your depths and do everything you possibly can to take care of them. And in Africa, it really is true that it takes a village to raise a child. So the grandmother groups all over Africa in 15 countries that get grants from the Stephen Lewis Foundation are full of grandmothers who are helping each other meet this challenge.
Joanne told a story yesterday about a woman who just, I can't remember the circumstances, but she just plopped down and she just wanted to give up. Until she realized that people were counting on her, and then she just, through sheer will, got up and like, okay, I'm gonna take care of you, I'm gonna take care of you, I'm gonna take care of you.
Yeah. These grandmothers really literally have nothing. They're too old to work. They are very, very poor. They're in a real pickle. And they know that the only people that they can count on are themselves and the other grandmothers who are also sharing this experience. The woman who started GAPA, the South African group that I talked about, told me, you know, it is really amazing what people can do to heal each other.
when they discover that they're not alone, that if they are themselves HIV positive, there are others who have had that experience, that others have lost children. If they talk to each other, there is a kind of group therapy that happens naturally without any particular guidance or expertise. And somehow they begin to heal themselves. It's quite remarkable.
Where the heck are the grandfathers? Why? I mean, in some of these stories, some of them are not just absent, but also, I mean, they're there and they're also perpetrating some of the negative things going on.
You're thinking about Swaziland.
Yeah.
I'll get to Swaziland in a minute. Many of the grandfathers are dead. Women do live longer than men. Sadness. But in Africa, many of the grandfathers, like many men, are so afraid of HIV/AIDS that they aren't tested. It's true of women as well. The discrimination is extraordinary. The stigma is very great. So many of the men aren't there. In the case of Swaziland, we were talking yesterday about a wonderful woman named Sipili Shlope, they say in her language. She lived in Swaziland. She was a very bright little girl who was willing to walk 9 miles a day, four and a half, and then get on a bus to go to school. But her family couldn't afford to send her. Smart, sparkly girl. And she walked up the steps to the office of Save the Children, knocked on the door, and asked to talk to the director. And she was like, nine. And he said, children don't apply to us directly. But he was so impressed that he put her in touch with a Norwegian family who sponsored her not only through elementary school, but high school and university. And after she graduated from university, she had been selected to go to study agriculture at a university in the UK. In order to be allowed to go, it was necessary for her to have a physical exam. And the doctor who administered that exam discovered that she was HIV positive. And the doctors are not supposed to tell them. But he was so shocked he knew her, and he was so amazed to discover that she was positive that he told her, and she was stunned. She had not been with another man. Her husband had never been tested for HIV, was never a subject of discussion. She went home and told him that she was not going to England after all. He threw her out with the children. There were five. He left. His family threw her out, actually. And it was soon after that that she discovered that other women were experiencing that same stigma. And she said, this is wrong. I'm going to start a group of HIV-positive grandmothers. By that time, she had four children and five adopted. And teach them how to take care of themselves, how to understand how AIDS is transmitted so everyone isn't quite as scared as they are, how to access antiretroviral drugs, how to protect their children from this disease, how to earn money. So I was with her groups in Swaziland, grandmothers who knew that nutrition was key in addition to ARVs, antiretroviral drugs, nutrition was key. We're planting huge community gardens, and they would bring the youngest toddlers with them, and they would be planting huge rows of corn and peas and beans, and she has done it. And I said to her, how do you, who are HIV positive and being treated yourself, find the strength and the stamina to do the work that you're doing? And she said, I don't have any options. This work has to be done. I forget that I'm HIV positive. As I watch other people get out of their sick beds and somehow become healthier again. It's a wonderful, wow. Wonderful story.
So if I want to be like you when I grow up,
or if all of us want to be like you,
what do we have
How
to do?
How old are
what?
You?
I'm 53, so I have two more
well,
years.
Well, get on it. You have many years.
What do you suggest for all of us to do what you're doing, to identify these things that need to be identified in life, and what should we do to make things better?
Oh, I think everybody here knows of things that they could do. Even around here, I mean, you don't have to travel all over the world to make a contribution. Many of you, I'm sure from having talked to you earlier, are already engaged in volunteer activities that are very important in this city, in this region, in this state, in this country, and internationally. I know some of you have children and grandchildren who are doing that as well. I talked to someone who was going to Haiti. In fact, she bought a book. We had a wonderful conversation. I'm dying to go to Haiti. You have a son who is right now in Uganda. But you don't have to travel around the world to do good things. And I think it will take all of us, as I said, very serious, working together everywhere to make our world better for our grandchildren.
So why have you chosen the route to travel? Is there something cathartic in it for you? Is there something in your past that made you choose this path?
I feel blessed to be able to do this work. I mean, you can't imagine how much time I spend sitting on the floor of somebody's hut listening to them. I mean, how fortunate I am. When I first began this work, I thought, why would anybody talk with me? I mean, first of all, I am white, and many of the people I talk to aren't. I'm from the United States, and everybody is convinced that we have gold in the streets. So they think I have lots of money. For sure, I have a good education, and many of them are illiterate. Why would anyone tell me anything, I thought, as I was flying for the first time to Poland and then Turkey on a test shoot? And I was amazed. You know, women are not listened to in many parts of the world. Their voices are inaudible. And the fact that I had come so far just to listen to them, tell me your story, opened an unbelievable rich experience to me. And I felt so blessed. Why would I want to stop doing this? I'm very, very fortunate.
Yes.
So, Tony?
Yes.
It's me.
Yes.
I am going to bring Jackson Kaguri on stage. So let me give you the introduction. You get a break for about 10 minutes. I want to tell you guys about Jackson because he is an amazing person, and we're so honored to have you here tonight. Jackson Kaguri grew up in a small village in Uganda, and he was a very passionate student, and that led him to study at a university in Kampala. And when he graduated, maybe even before he graduated, began working on human rights, formed a nonprofit. He ended up here in this country, studied in Colombia as a visiting scholar, and he studied human rights advocacy, which I didn't even know was a major, but I think my daughter wants to major in it. And in 2001, Jackson founded, and I'm hoping I'm pronouncing it right, the Nayaka Project? Yeah? Okay. So, it operates 3 schools, a farm, a medical clinic, and 2 water systems. It supports children who have been orphaned by AIDS. Jackson is an author and has received a lot of awards. Some of them include the 2015 Weislitz Global Citizen Award. CNN named him as their 2012 hero. He was recognized in Time Magazine's Power of One. This is a guy who grew up in a tiny village in Uganda. And our sustaining sponsor, Paul Sutherland of the FIM Group, he wanted to introduce Jackson personally tonight. But weirdly, Paul is in Uganda doing his own very good work. With that said, please come to the stage, Jackson. I want you just to tell them about all the great stuff you're doing in Uganda with the grandmothers and the AIDS orphans.
It is bright up here. And since Tony talked about me, you can compare the brightest shot.
Thanks, Jackson.
Alia, Granny Paura, that's how I call her, asked you how many of you have a grandmother. I already had my speech all figured out what I was going to say, then I changed it. So I'm going to tell you about my own grandmother. I grew up in a tiny village in Uganda, very tiny, you can't find it on Google Map. But in that tiny village, I was surrounded by the love of grandmothers all over the village, including my maternal grandmother, Mariza. Mariza is Martha in English. My grandmother was so special to me, so much that every time Mom fed us, after lunch, I would sneak from home and go to my grandmother's house. About a mile and a half of running quickly, because Mom is expecting you to be around the house, I would run to my grandmother's house, and as soon as I arrived, she would get up wherever she was seated, get with her stick, and walk and give me a big hug. She made me feel so special. And then she would say, come. And we'd go inside the house on this wooden made bed, and she would crunch down and reach under that bed and pull out small banana. A small banana that would not be eaten in this country, especially my children don't like those bananas with black dots on it. Those are old bananas. And she would pull it out and say, sit down. I'll sit on the floor, that floor, no worrying about the dust, and peel that banana, eat it very quickly, swallow, and run back home. It didn't matter how full I was, I looked forward to a banana from my grandmother. I felt so special, and she told me I was a special one. My grandmother had 26 grandchildren. After that banana, she made sure you walked through the back door as you ran home. And unbeknown to us, another grandchild was coming from the other door, getting a banana, walking the other side. It was a line that continuously happened every single day, and grandmother made sure none of us ever met, so that we grew up thinking, I am the special. At 46 years of age, when I think of my grandmother, I think of love, care, and a special woman. And so when I finished school and started building schools for children who are orphaned by HIV/AIDS, students and children whose parents have passed away and left them in the hands of grandmothers like my grandmother, I could not help but think the best way for them to be loved and feel special is to put them in the hands of grandmothers. Ladies and gentlemen, grandmothers in my village don't have to be related to you. I have five grandchildren and adopted. Adopted, in fact, in my village is not used. They would tell you, I have 20 grandchildren. And you go, wow, how? And then they tell you, how those children are. So I knew for children who are orphaned, left behind, the only way for them to get the love, the care, the only way for them to wake up next morning and walk 10 miles to school is only if they have a grandmother in their life. And so we went throughout the village. This happened after Stephen Lewis Foundation that Paola already mentioned had invited grandmothers from our village who are raising these children, and two women got on a plane in Uganda. For the first time, they sat in a car. For the first time, they got a pair of shoes. For the first time, they got to the airport and got in a plane. These are religious women who love God, who have worshipped all their lives. One was 75, you met them. One was 65. And when they got on a plane, one of them got so tired of shoes and everything they had put her through. She took the shoes off. She got her wrap. She wrapped it all. I am at Pearson Airport in Toronto. And she had put it on her head and walked out of the plane. Made a spectacle, but made a good press pictures. When she hugged me, she told me, "My son Jackson, I've never thought of heaven. I've gotten heaven today." Literary and figurative, heaven to her is up. The plane took them in the air. What she saw in a plane and what she was seeing there was the love and care they read in the Bible, that one day people will get along regardless of gender, regardless of color. And in Toronto, surrounded by grandmothers of different races, of different economic activities, there she was, surrounded by love and happiness. So we went back home, we organized grandmothers. Grandmothers who, some of them are 35 years of age, up to 80, 90, as long as you live with children, you are part of grandmothers program at Nyaka. Ladies and gentlemen, we are now working with 7,004 grandmothers. That number has stayed the same for the last 6, 7 years, and people ask me how many die and they add in more grandmothers. The waiting list to get in the grandmothers program is enormous. They are turned down to join these groups. These grandmothers form solidarity to support each other, to love and care their grandchildren. Instead of worrying about school fees and books, Nyaka provides that education for the children so the grandmothers can keep bananas under their beds and make their children special. For grandmothers who can't read and write, literacy writers, you will appreciate this, grandmothers are the best teachers. They tell you stories, they tell you traditions, they are the only photographs who will describe to you how your parents looked like, what they did, how they did it. They have everything in their head. And once you lose a grandmother in our culture, you have lost wisdom. You have lost your library. You have lost the bananas. But you have also lost love and kindness. So 7,000 grandmothers raising 43,000 children. Through the Stephen Lewis Foundation, we are able to build some of these grandmothers the first home ever in their lives. Some live in a tent with 10 children. Others live in grass-thatched houses. And one story I will tell you, one of these grandmothers is raising 5 children. They come to Nyaka School every day, and they come in a clean purple and white uniform. Monday through Friday, the uniform is crisp, clean. So I went and asked her, "Your roof leaks. It's a rainy season right now. How are your grandchildren keeping their uniforms clean?" And she told me, "When it rains, in the middle of the night, I grab all 5 uniforms, fold them up, sleep on top of them. Rain will drop on my back all night long, so my children can go to school in a clean uniform. No social security, no retirement fund. They've never been to a salon. They have never eaten at Cherry Republic. But the love, the care, the support they give is the only reason orphans, children, grown men still feel the love. Without the grandmothers, without your work, without the support of the Stephen Lewis Foundation, without Jessica introducing me to this community right here, without all the grandmothers here who have participated, these grandmothers would still laugh, would still enjoy, but they would lose the opportunity to create memories of the next generation whose parents have died, who are now at grandmother's foot. They will lose the opportunity to keep bananas for their grandchildren because they are worried how the child is going to go to school. So in fact, what Nyaka does is to be the parent so the grandmothers can continue to be grandmothers. Outside the room, you will see they are not sitting down waiting for donations only. They work hard. They make jewelry. They make baskets. I've decided to write books about these grandmothers and children so they can see themselves in the stories. When their grandchildren are reading my children's books, they say, I think they are talking about you right here. It's not a picture, exact picture, but their story is written, and because of that, their grandchildren are more curious to read something about them. And then when I go to lead and school to speak, children are now reading about students, their sisters and brothers around the world, and how they live. I was told to do 10 minutes. If you let me go, I might go for 2 hours. This is how I want to end. I want to end by telling you, as my grandmother saw my brother die of HIV/AIDS, as she saw my sister die of HIV/AIDS and started looking at great-grandchildren now, she started saying, I want to die. Why am I still here while my grandchildren are passing away? The greatest pain these grandmothers go through is the pain of seeing their children die. And then they become like sponges, sucking out everyone who's pain and taking it all in so their grandchildren can smile. What you see in those photographs are years of sucking in the pain of others, giving up eating a banana so all 26 children can have a piece of banana, but giving hope and happiness to a 46-year-old man who still remembers a banana from the grandmother. Thank you very much.
Well, that was pretty incredible. Thank you. So we've got one microphone for Q&A, and speak in the microphone so that we can get it on tape. Thank you.
Questions? Anybody? We have one right up front, front row.
My question is, in all the travels that you all have done, did you take a translator with you? How could you speak to Turkish people? And you must have.
I didn't take one with me. I always find someone who is local and knows the women and who speaks English and agrees to act as my interpreter. It's a good question, though, because it's... I have been able to find one virtually everywhere. There's always someone, maybe a student, Sometimes the English is not as good as what we all would speak. It's okay, because they understand me well enough to communicate my questions. And I will, after I've drafted the chapters, send them back to that interpreter to read back to the women I have interviewed. And they have the right to do fact checking. So if I got it wrong, if I misunderstood them, I will fix it right away.
We have a question here.
Hi there. I'm wondering if you guys can tell me your first memory of hearing someone tell you a story, or your first memory of reading a book.
First memory of writing a book?
Reading
a book. Oh, that's a tough one.
I can remember. I think it was Pat the Bunny. I'm pretty sure.
Mine was the Bible. I grew up in a village where there were no books. And so the only book in the house was the Bible, Mom's Bible. In fact, Mom would slap our hands for messing up with her Bible. And so my memories of writing is writing down anything that went wrong in my life. When Dad spanked me, I went in my room and wrote it down. Death, the spanking, and what I would do after when I grow up. Those were my memories. Bible has been my book to read. I still read it every day.
Hi, Paula, and thank you, Jackson, for your inspiring words. Paula, as you've gone around the world and been empowering grandmothers, you mentioned it a couple times, but I'd like to hear a little bit more of your thoughts on the grandfathers that are not there, and are those grandmothers that you're trying to empower, is it even more difficult for them to be empowered as they fight off some of the men and the grandfathers, or however that society has kept them down? Can you go into that, and have you found supportive grandfathers, and is there some hope for us?
First of all, I love you, Tim. There is hope. Grandfathers are, I should say that as I have done now 5 books about women and girls activists around the world, and there are some parts of the world where men are involved and there are some parts where they are not. And sometimes I have found men involved in places that surprised me very much. For example, I was documenting the work of the Girl Child Network in Zimbabwe, which you may know.
Yes, Ed.
They have men on staff. They work with girls who have been raped. And it's so crucial that they have men who can be good men, role models, so that they understand that all men are not violent and violent brutes, and so they aren't afraid of men, and so they can grow up into having healthy relationships, that they have men on staff, and they choose them very carefully. They are often men who were themselves born of rape, or their mothers or their sisters have been raped. So they are very sensitive to the issue of child rape. I think they couldn't function without having the men involved in those roles. You know that the Canadian grandmothers include grandothers. We have a grandother sitting right here. He says, to expand our view, that it's not just men who are grandothers, but there are many women who are involved in grandmothers and grandothers who don't actually have grandchildren themselves. So there is much to be done in many ways working on these issues of social justice in which men can be involved and I think must be. You know, we've come a long way from the 1960s when the feminists in this country excluded men from women's studies classes. Today, in fact, if we really expect to work together as equals, I think men must be involved in issues that have to do with women and their families, and I know that has been true in your family. Look at you guys. I mean, you are an example to us all.
What I can add on quickly, once the grandmothers formed in our community, we cover about three counties. The grandmothers have become so successful, not only economically, they make more money now selling their baskets. We buy all the baskets, everything they make, we sell it here. So we guarantee them everything they make, the organization will buy it from them. So when you go out, please buy everything there. So we can get grandmothers to make more. But because they have been successful, now the grandfathers in our village have approached me with a group. Guess what they call themselves? Grandfathers group. And they would love to know you asked that question, so you can tell them that solidarity piece we encourage. How does a grandfather in the United States be a grandfather? What do you go through? And they share what they go through. And that is where we are going to change so many of these customs, because many of these grandfathers have never touched a baby. When we landed in Canada, a grandmother was kissed by Stephen Lewis on the cheek, and she jumped up and said, "Oh my God! My first kiss ever." 75 years of age. I said, "Are you sure?" She said, "Say yeah." He never kissed me. He only had sex with me when we are going to have a baby. That's all. No hug, no kiss. 75, 9 children. And I said, "So how do you know about a kiss?" She said, "Women always know more than men." True story.
We have a question here, back here.
Hi. I'm not a grandmother, but I did travel the world, and I took my three kids to 90 countries in 2 years.
Wow.
And I naively didn't think that was going to change me. And of course it did, and I came back and started a nonprofit, and the tagline was Women Empowering Women. And what I want to know from your experience seeing the groups, is there a common obstacle? Are there, you know, a few obstacles, and how do those organizations overcome those obstacles?
Yeah, I'll give a shout out to it. If you ask any nonprofit leader in many parts of the world, ask them that question, they will tell you money. Yes. But that's not what I'm going to tell you, because actually money is not the biggest obstacle. The biggest obstacle is access to information. Many of these groups cannot raise money because they don't have access. Many of them spend a lot of time trying to raise money, so much that many of you get tired of being asked money. But if they could educate you the things they go through, then money would follow. If they could convince you to visit and drink tea with them, instead of going to Paris and to the bar, and to Cancun, to the beach, they spend one trip in a village where I come from and see a grandmother who cannot afford to pay sanitary product for their granddaughter, but will spend that money to buy you a Coke because you are a guest. Then you'd think twice when you go to Starbucks every morning rather than give her a donation. So the access to information, educating you, knowing what it takes. $5 with my children who are out there for ice cream is not a problem for me. For a grandmother in my village, it jump starts a business that will give forever. So they don't get access to you to explain information. They don't get to thank you in a way that Americans want to be thanked. They don't get to go in your will because you don't know about them. You live in your will, Michigan State Football Club. Yeah, football is more important to many people than saving your grandmother. So it's not because it's because they can't have access to you. You don't know, and they don't know how to reach you. And I think that's where Nyaka has been lucky, that we can sit in Traverse City and convince you to put Nyaka in your will. access, information, education. If my children understand what other children go through in Nicaragua, my girls understand that girls at their age are sold in slavery to be sex workers today in 2016 in India, they will spend differently, they will ask differently for iPads, they will sleep differently, they will say different prayer than God give me more ice cream. It's access and education.
I was thinking, Jackson and I both go annually to a poverty conference in Mexico. And the people who go to that conference are funders and nonprofit organizations that need funding. It was started by a friend of ours who in 2008, in the economic down spiral, realized that nonprofits were really struggling for money. And he said to himself, I think the only possibility is that nonprofits are going to have to work together to maximize the fewer resources that they have. And my grandchildren, I have two granddaughters, are 8 and 10. They were at this point, yes, 5 and 8. And they said, can we go to this conference? And their father, who goes with me, and who is also a pal, Jackson, said, well, it's really not a conference for children. And they said, well, it should be. So they were very busy. They were making yellow sticky notes and gluing it on all the windows. And they had the idea that the delegates from all over the world should bring their children, because if they could learn about each other and become friends, maybe someday they would grow up and work together to face the, to change the problems that face people everywhere. So the deal is that if you come to this conference with your child, you come for 1 hour, Jackson has done it several times,
yes, ma'am,
and teach the rest of the kids with your child, joint presentation, teach the rest of the kids what it's like to be a kid in your country. So we have a great lineup for this year. They're going to be cooking ugali. You know what ugali is? It's flour and water bread. It's a staple. This guy is from Kenya, I think. So they sing and they dance together, and they play games, and they envision the future together and draw. It's really an amazing experiment. And the kids just made it up. I hope it helps.
It does.
One more question. Back here.
So you've talked about the children and you've talked about the grandmothers. In many of these countries, the mothers themselves have not died. Can you say more about that generation?
In many of these countries, the mothers also have died.
Okay.
The fathers and the mothers. In many countries where I've been in Africa, the whole sort of parent generation is gone. We have the children and the grandmothers.
Yeah, so that's the term that I don't think this is an American English word, child-headed families. And Nyaka has had actually a success story where three children, both parents died. The last one was infected with HIV/AIDS. We discovered them when the oldest was 9, taking care of her siblings, living in a house by themselves, and brought all of them into Nyaka school. We asked them if we could put them in a different grandmother house, and they said no. They wanted to stay in their own house. That girl, Abia, has finished the school at Nyaka, went to a teaching college, and now she's an employee of our organization. Full cycle. But some do have a mother who is infected with HIV/AIDS. Most of the time, the man dies and the woman still lives. And that's when they find out that actually she has HIV/AIDS and they go on medication. My brother died in 1996. His wife still lives today because we are able to buy them her medication. Medication that she must take every single day, about 10 different pills. So they are weak, they are hurting, weight goes up and down, they are scratching. So it is a miserable life, and when you are doing that and you still have to tend to 5 children, to feed them, to clothe them, it's a difficult life out there. But majority have died. Those who are there are still struggling in poverty. And because HIV/AIDS takes long to kill somebody, by the time the husband dies, most of the property has been sold. So HIV/AIDS has that economic repercussions, social repercussions, spiritual. Every aspect of life is touched because a patient has lived for a long time.
The end of the conversation, remember I began by describing talking with grandmothers in Kenya and how many children and grandchildren they told me they had. I was so stunned by what I heard, I just got tears in my eyes. I mean, this is not the objective reporter who is supposed to just listen and report. And I said, oh my God, there is so much sorrow here. What do you say to help each other? And there was real silence. And finally, one grandmother said, we say God is helping us because we are here to take care of the children. It's a wonderful attitude, an astonishing, wonderful attitude.
Good job.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. What an amazing night. I'm so glad you came to Traverse City. We're going to end with Joanne O'Shea. Paola talked about her and the Grandmothers and Others group in Canada. Joanne told me yesterday they raised $435,000 since they founded 6 years ago. 10 years ago. So Joanne is going to do a gratitude dance. Would you like to say a few words before?
Hello. yes, I'm going to do the gratitude dance. You can see why I am full of gratitude. I was at the 2006 gathering and got to meet these grandmothers. I know Jackson. I know Paola. I could dance all day. We did dance because we made so much money, because we'd like to win the lottery and send the money. We've already won the lottery of life. We live, we have everything we need. Our grandchildren have everything we need. So join me in the gratitude dance.